Good evening. I'm Susan Koretsky. I'm a professor of art here at Vassar and a graduate of class of 1963. Also with John Mahaley, co-chair of the Sesquicentennial Committee. Notice how well I said that. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to this celebration. As the video you've just seen demonstrates, Vassar people have never lacked a sense of humor. Indeed, I have been hearing lately that our mutual commemoration of the college's long and distinguished history is being referred to around campus as the squeaky. Have you heard that? Think about it, it's actually very quite witty. To take part in these observances as a student, as a member of the faculty, administration or staff, or as a graduate of Vassar, is to nearly burst with pride. A birthday of 150 years is surely worth the lighting of some candles, but it's not the years alone that make a great institution. It's the consistency of its aspirations and ambitions, the sense of shared purpose that can develop when a group of curious, dedicated, and determined individuals set out to establish the most potent environment for personal and intellectual growth. A college for women in the 1860s, how remarkable. And yet, the story goes on and on, because there are others, no less dedicated and determined than the founders, who continued building the institution, decade after decade after decade. All of us know how well they succeeded. The performance you're about to see and hear is a tribute to all of them, an affirmation that we honor the quality of their work and we strive to uphold it. Today's program features music by Vassar choral groups, a staged reading starring Vassar student actors, and a film collage that will conclude the proceedings. Like all aspects of this birthday celebration, Vassar Voices is a homegrown product, so to speak. From the research to the writing, from direction to music, from cast to crew, it exists because of the time, energy, and creativity of members of the Vassar community. What you're about to see is not an attempt to relate the complete history of the college in less than an hour. Not even Vassar people work fast enough for that. Instead, this performance is an effort to capture the singular personality of the college down through the years, through the words of some of the individuals, some of them are well known, some not, who have lived the Vassar experience over the last century and a half. As such, it's an affirmation of what we've believed in from the start, the importance and the power of words to illuminate and to educate, to amuse and to move. So it's with great pleasure now that I introduce the cast of Vassar Voices.
Matthew Vassar, diary for April 13, 1861. We staked out the ground for the foundation of our college, a day which was made singularly memorable by the fall of Fort Sumter, and subsequent letters, 1861. A crisis is now upon us. Whether to halt until the issue of our national troubles are settled, or to proceed. Considerations we have duly weighed and finally resulted in our determination to proceed with our work. When our plans were first made public, they were met with many discouraging objections. But time and reflection have, I am rejoiced to find, won for us numerous friends.
1864. Mariah Mitchell's observatory is constructed on the campus. April 9th, 1865. General Lee surrenders at Appomattox. Less than a week later, President Lincoln is assassinated. September 23rd, 1865. The first students arrive at Vassar. The comprehensive fee is $350.
From John Raymond to his wife, Saturday evening, September 23rd, 1865.
It seems like a dream. The sudden transmutation of this great lumbering pile of brick and mortar, which hung on my spirit like a mountainous millstone, into a palace of light and life. Last evening, I walked quietly down the front avenue to the Gate Lodge under the dim light of the stars, and then turned to look at the college. It was illuminated from end to end. On every side, it sparkled like a diamond. The front windows open on the corridors, which were all ablaze with gas. Everywhere, merry voices were heard in conversation and song. At the rear, the pianos were going, and you would have thought the building had been inhabited for years instead of hours. We have a fine set of students, and they make themselves at home at once. Mr. Vassar has only just lived through it. He is almost sick of joy.
Christine Ladd Franklin, class of 1868. Letters home, September 20th, 1866.
With great sorrow, I at once confess that I am grievously disappointed in Vassar. Instead of the independent university of my imagination, and instead of the tall, intelligent, and enthusiastic young women in blue merino that I fancied, I find a troop of young girls who wear black chamois and are wholly given up to the tyranny of fashion.
And 2 days later, September 22nd, 1866.
I begin to think that in time we shall see a college that will answer our highest expectations.
2 years later, September 20th, 1868.
In astronomy, I had the pleasure of working out an original demonstration of the sextant, which was
very gratifying
to Miss Mitchell.
Molly Pope Silver, letters home. 1866.
We all assembled in chapel with quaking hearts, for a most severe lecture was expected from President Raymond. It came, and it was severe too. He ended by saying,
"That hereafter, any young lady who should break any rule of the college, even having her gas burning 5 minutes after 10, without an important and sufficient reason, should be expelled immediately."
Isn't that tough? I had no idea before that the laws of the college were so sacred. I do hope it will all come out right in the end, though, for some of the nicest girls in the college are the most to blame.
1866, Founders Day is declared a holiday by the faculty. 1868, the class of 1868 plants the first class tree.
Matthew Vassar, in his final address to the Board of Trustees, June 23rd, 1868.
I do not pretend to understand much about classical education, and only offer these brief suggestions as suggestions for your more elaborate consideration, and hope you will give them such attention as you may think the subject demands for your future, but not present, action. For it is quite certain that if we only follow in the old beaten paths, we will make no progress. We do no more than others have done before us. We are only copyists, and not progressionists. My motto is progress.
Mariah Mitchell, later that same day.
Matthew Vassar is dead. I am sorry. I have met him at least once a day for 3 years. Mr. Vassar had a fancy for size. He must build the biggest building. He must have the largest number of students and so forth. The girls must be taught everything. His schemes were innumerable, but he grew as the building went up, and he seemed to me, though not a small man when I first saw him, almost a great man when he left us. He built up so grand a structure, it so grew upon his hands, and he so grew himself that genius only could have been at the base. He was growing when he died. I think he would have been willing to see women among the trustees.
1871, the newly formed Alumni Association initiates a scholarship fund made possible by a bequest by Matthew Vassar. The student magazine is renamed the Vassar Miscellany. 1880, telephone service is established at Vassar.
From Three Vassar Girls Abroad, a novel by Elizabeth Williams Champney, class of 1869, published in 1882.
Mademoiselle Maud does not wish to marry? Why is that?
She is too young, and she has not yet finished her course at Vassar.
What then is this Vassar? Is it a convent? A religious house?
Oh, dear, no. That is, it is quite religious enough, but not in the way that you mean. It is a college, where we take all of the higher studies, mathematical astronomy, Greek, and Latin.
And is Mademoiselle Maud passionately devoted to Latin?
She detests it, but it's in the curriculum, you know, and we have to take it. She is devoted to art, and after she graduates, she intends to become an artist. She will never marry. Nobody could induce her.
But suppose I also became a great artist. Could I not in that way win her admiration?
She would not care for you unless you turned out a genius, and you do not look in the least like one.
Later, that same novel.
It seems a pity, with all our Western wealth, we do not build chateaux in America.
We do better. We build colleges. And indeed, Vassar resembles a French chateau more than I would have thought. Just wait till the vines have a chance to grow and the dear old pile to mellow into venerable age, and Vassar, in the midst of her noble park, be able to hold up her head for a picturesque interest with any ducal chateau in sunny France.
But Vassar has no noble sculptures or glorious stained glass.
She will have. Girls don't usually have a great many jewels. Vassar is young yet. She will gain her diamonds as years go by. She has done enough for us, and it is for us girls to decorate her in return. When I come into my property, I mean to make the chapel a present of one memorial window. That will make the others look so mean that other alumni maybe will be minded to complete the set.
1884, the daisy chain makes its first appearance at commencement. 1892, Professor Woodrow Wilson of Princeton University visits campus and lectures on democracy. 1893, Strong Hall, the first dormitory, is completed.
November 9th, 1895, Vassar becomes the first women's college in the United States to hold a field day. A total of 17 girls participate in the 100-yard dash, the running broad jump, the running high jump, and the 220-yard dash. An onlooker comments.
The performance in the high jump was better than it appears on paper, for owing to the fact that the competitors wear bloomers of the most ample kind, the bar has to be cleared some 4 inches to allow for the sweep of these nether garments. In the future, some ingenious athlete will reduce her bloomer circumference by 2 or 3 inches, and the Vassar record for the high jump will be broken.
Fanny Prado Simpson, Letters Home, November 3rd, 1898.
My dear kid's sister, I am now at a Latin lecture, but it is so stupid and boring that instead of taking notes, I am going to try to keep awake by writing to you. Why does that stupid professor keep on talking? It is a beautiful day. Oh, another joke by the professor, tee hee, tee hee. The prof is a handsome looking man, knit. His clothes sort of hang on him, and he talks along in the slowest, stupidest way. One of his arms is akimbo, if you know what that means, and he stands nobly there before about 160 girls. Poor thing. Oh, he stopped. It's all over, so I must say goodbye.
May 2nd, 1899.
My dear papa, well, of all unlucky girls, your daughter is the worst. She drew 109th choice for a room and got a parlor with 3 bedrooms in Maine with Caroline Stoddart and Ruth Johnson. The girls are fine, but the room...
May 30th, 1899.
Of course, I shall try to pass, but the exams are going to be hard, and you must not be surprised if I flunk any.
Jean Webster, class of 1901.
Later to achieve fame as the author of Daddy Long Legs.
By my senior year, the censor knew that I was pretty truthful, and she sometimes let my stuff go through without reading it. One week came along which was very scant of news, and I could find nothing on earth to write about. I hungrily scanned the bulletin board, but the only news item was the announcement that Professor Frost of Yerkes Observatory would lecture before the college upon the theory of the sidereal system. I'd never studied astronomy, and I only knew one girl among my intimate friends who had, so I turned to her room to see if I could not gather a few spicy details. Where is Yerkes University? Is it on Pike's Peak? Medelia opened her innocent, wide eyes and looked at me in horror at my ignorance.
No, it's in Dublin, Ireland.
In Dublin? I was perfectly sure it was in America.
Oh no, everybody knows that. It's very famous.
I commenced taking surreptitious notes. What has he discovered?
Oh, he is very famous. He's discovered the rings of Saturn and the Milky Way.
Nonsense. I've heard of them all my life. I could have discovered the Milky Way myself.
Oh, the phenomenon had been observed but never had been explained.
How did he happen to do it?
He went up. In a balloon. You see, it gets him so much nearer to the stars.
I left her and hastened down to my desk. I enlarged upon her meager details. I described the balloon and the apparatus he used when making the ascent. The editor didn't know much more about astronomy than I did and published it as it came. The next week, I received a note from the astronomy department asking me to call upon them for an interview. Astronomers have a very slight sense of humor.
1901. Ida Watson, class of 1901, discovers a new star in Perseus. 1902, a complete mastodon skeleton is erected in Avery Hall. 1909, Alice Hyler Ramsey, class of 1907, becomes the first woman to cross the North American continent behind the wheel of a car.
Minna Besser Geddes, class of 1916.
Freshman courses were prescribed with more leeway, but not much for upperclassmen. Science, mathematics, a foreign language, English, and Latin were required. Chemistry was interesting until I burned my finger in the laboratory. Now, many of those earlier courses elude me, except one. The course on newspapers by the famed historian, our own Professor Lucy Salmon, with her emphasis on authoritativeness and sources of news, made a great impression.
Beware of headlines!
She cautioned.
Their aim is to attract attention, not accuracy. Headlines commit unnumbered sins of inaccuracy.
Thus spoke Professor Salmon.
Julia Coburn Antolini, class of 1918.
I remember the great Lucy Salmon, some of whose precepts I have carried through my own teaching and other things that I have done. Lucy Salmon was a big woman with a very high little voice, and she liked to talk in the third person. So sometimes she would say,
"The instructor is asked what the instructor wants. The instructor does not want anything."
And then once, when she was asked how long a paper should be, she said,
"I don't know how long it should be. I have two friends. One is 5 feet tall, one is 6 feet tall. I value them both equally."
Miss Salmon, as I say, had her own methods of instruction, which made you look at everything around you and see how it would become historical material. For an examination in American history, this was typical of her usual kind of course. She gave every student a railroad timetable and said,
"It is up to you to deduce about American history from this railroad timetable."
This was the entire exam.
1913, the day before President Woodrow Wilson is to be inaugurated, Inez Milholland, class of 1909, leads a suffrage parade in Washington, D.C., riding through crowds of drunken men atop a large white horse, wearing a crown and a long white cape. 1916, the Shakespeare Garden is planned by English drama and botany students. 1918, some 200 Vassar graduates serve overseas in the Great War. Four of these young women never make it home.
Julia Coburn Antolini, class of 1918.
In our senior year was the fire in Maine. The fire was at dinner time when we were all in the back wing, now enclosed by the college center. They were trying to get valuables out of the front of Maine, and faculty members apparently were taking things out. Prexy was seen carrying a bronze bust of some woman, maybe Mariah Mitchell or somebody, and he muttered,
"Hard work supporting a woman."
1920, the 19th Amendment grants women the right to vote. The college receives a tank from the French government in gratitude for the service of Vassar women during the recent war. It sits on Jocelyn Hockey Field for the next two decades. 1923, Edna St. Vincent Millay, class of 1917, wins the Pulitzer Prize for poetry.
Sonnet 42. What lips my lips have kissed, and where and why I have forgotten, and what arms have lain under my head till morning. But the rain is full of ghosts tonight, that tap and sigh upon the glass and listen for reply. And in my heart there stirs a quiet pain for unremembered lads that not again will turn to me at midnight with a cry. Thus in winter stands the lonely tree, nor knows what birds have vanished one by one, yet knows its boughs more silent than before. I cannot say what loves have come and gone. I only know that summer sang in me a little while, that in me sings no more.
1927, the first students participate in junior year abroad.
November 1928, to the editors of the Quarterly. Perhaps your readers would be interested to hear of the evolution of a bit of Vassar slang. J no longer means simply the bare room where one dances. The term has been transferred to dances themselves. Nearly every Saturday, there seems to be an informal dance in some hall, and I mean a dance with men attending. These are J's.
Having a man up for the J.
There's a J in students.
Incidentally, I should like to express hearty approval of this weekend influx of young men. How much more natural, pleasant, and satisfactory it must be than the days, my own included, when the sight of a pair of trousers on the campus was the cause, if not of swooning, at least of a rush to the corridor windows of Maine. From a rather old-timer.
Lucille Fletcher Wallop, class of 1933.
Do you remember Founders Day and dressing up in crazy costumes? I can still see Peggy Proctor on horseback riding around the circle, and myself on a donkey, she being Don Quixote and I Sancho Panza, and Jan McLeod, Fran Armstrong, and I as three cockroaches from Maine. I was a small, old-fashioned roach, and Fran and Jan represented the newer, larger, more vigorous generation. The college authorities didn't think it was funny.
Eunice Clark Jessup, class of 1933.
If we contributed our untutored might to the social and literary revolutions of the era, the sexual revolution was lost on us. Aside from a furtive look at Lady Chatterley's lover and some uncomprehending yak about Freud, we were basically jeune fille en fleur. A good friend came up to me late at night my senior year and said,
"If I told you I wasn't a virgin, would you hate me?"
One can imagine the clank of that remark in today's Vassar. We considered Mary McCarthy to be on a level of sophistication we wouldn't attain until after marriage, if then, a hunch that her subsequent novels bore out. Not only was she going to marry an actor, a species that none of us had ever seen except across footlights, but she bought her clothes at Saks instead of Peck and Peck. Another girl said to me once,
"Mary McCarthy says there are perverts who make love to dead bodies. Can that be true?"
"Well," I answered weakly, "if Mary says so." It was a great faculty, but they couldn't tell us everything.
Margaret Culkin Banning, class of 1912, writing in 1935.
I have often thought, since that strike at Beacon on Hudson, that most of us wouldn't have known a thing about it unless some of our daughters had gone there to picket for the strikers. I myself first heard about it on Easter morning when a telegram from my daughter told me that there was a stir at college about the picketing and that there had been some unpleasant publicity. In my response, I wrote that I thought that she could not, while she was a Vassar student, do such things without involving the college in grave criticism and controversy, that her immediate business was to find out what was wrong with the economic system by studying basic causes, and that her opportunity for action would come later. And I think I added that her courage and evidenced human sympathy with the strikers were very pleasing. Her answer to that was that she thought I had made some good points, but that she didn't agree entirely. She wrote further,
"I was reading an old copy of the Miscellany the other day, and I came upon this statement in a commencement speech.
College students were fulfilling their specific social function when they picketed in the shirtwaist strike 2 years ago. Congratulations, Mother. You wrote that yourself in 1912.
Kathleen R. McInerney, October 1935.
What is a radical? I spent my senior year trying to define the term. Matthew Vassar was condemned as a radical. Most of our social legislation, including public schools, in its infancy was branded radical. The term changes, differing in the era in which it is used, and a true historical approach should give the word no condemning connotations. As a group, the radicals are no more messy than the dramatic production people clothed in overalls from night to morn. The radical group at Vassar, as I knew them, were well-informed and filled a need to shake politically dormant students from their lethargy. As a group, they have as much right to exist as the Glee Club.
President Henry Noble McCracken, 1935.
I like to think that there is among the foremost of our students a common attitude towards life, which results out of the atmosphere of the institution and the general, though often inarticulate, public opinion on the campus. The ingredients of this Vassar point of view are doubtless many. For myself, the chief ingredient is tolerance, a respect for the opinions of others, whatever their color, race, or creed, and an endeavor to overcome one's personal prejudice wherever these are touched. Next to tolerance, I should place energy, for the Vassar ideal certainly has little tolerance for the idle. The third element may be called a social consciousness, wherever it takes the form of political action, religious work, or academic studies. A fourth ingredient is a keen yet honest critique of life. It gives to the college paper, to the daily talk on the campus, to the bulletin boards and the classroom that piquancy and fervor which is characteristic of Vassar today. These qualities have developed at Vassar because they have been the dominant characteristics of its most influential teachers. As I look back over my acquaintance with the Vassar faculty, and as I reread the history of the Vassar faculty of the past, these qualities seem to stand out as the dominant traits of its great teachers.
Julia Coburn Antolini, class of 1918, writing in 1937.
Look at a group of college women gathered together for an alumni or college club meeting. The average level of intelligence is probably high, but the level of clothes, sense, and taste is low. Must being a college graduate involve looking like a college graduate? Is there a type of dress that indicates brains and so sets one off from the rest of the population and absolves one from attention to attractiveness, grooming, and other standards? Does it indicate higher intellectual or spiritual attainments to look oblivious to one's effect upon one's fellow beings?
Hallie Flanagan, creator of the Vassar Experimental Theater and head of the Federal Theater Project, writing about events in 1938.
I was sworn in as a witness by Chairman Dyes, a rangy Texan with a cowboy drawl and a big black cigar. I wanted to talk about Federal Theater, but apparently the committee did not. I said that while the committee had recently been investigating un-American activity, I had been engaged for 4 years in combating un-American inactivity. The distinction was lost on the committee. I sketched the project's concern for the human values, the return of over 2,000 of our people to jobs in private industry. But the committee was not interested in any discussion of the project. Wasn't it true I taught at Vassar? Yes. Went to Russia? Yes.
Do you see this?
Congressman Starnes suddenly shouted, waving a yellow magazine aloft.
Ever see it before?
I said it seemed to be an old theater arts monthly. This described a meeting of workers' theaters in New York in 1931. Where did our audience come from? Was it true that we...
couldn't get any audiences for anything except communist plays?
No. The list submitted would show our wide audience support. Back to the article, a theater is born, and the phrase where I had described the enthusiasm of these theaters as having a certain Marlowe-esque madness.
You are quoting from this Marlowe,
observed Mr. Starnes.
Is he a communist?
The room rocked with laughter, but I did not laugh. 8,000 people might lose their jobs because a congressional committee had so prejudged us that even the classics were communistic. I said I was quoting from Christopher Marlowe.
Tell us who Marlowe is, so we can get the proper references, because that is all we want to do.
Put in the record that he was the greatest dramatist in the period of Shakespeare, immediately preceding Shakespeare.
Francis Prindle Taft, class of 1942.
The nation seems to have almost forgotten December 7th, 1941, but I know I will never forget. Nor will I forget that a group of us were with Prexy in his house. We had had a lovely lunch and were being entertained by a lovely young Japanese girl who was sitting on the floor playing a Japanese instrument that is rather like a zither. Suddenly, Mimi Dworsky-Obler burst into the president's house and announced the Pearl Harbor disaster. Neither Prexy nor his darling wife could think of one thing to say. Not surprisingly, neither could any of the senior class officers who were there. We said goodbye and departed.
1942. Having flown many an aircraft consigned to Britain under the Lend-Lease Act to the Canadian border, Nancy Harkness Love, class of 1935, who won considerable notoriety as a student at Vassar for learning how to fly an airplane, is appointed by the Secretary of War as director of the United States Air Force Women's Auxiliary Ferrying Squadron.
1945, a memorial service is held on campus for President Franklin D. Roosevelt, a Vassar trustee.
1946, Vassar opens its doors to its first male students, World War II veterans, who are admitted under a program aimed at easing the national emergency caused by the return of so many men looking to continue their education. Even women's colleges patriotically participate.
Vassar veteran Peter W. Berg, class of 1950.
For myself and many others, Vassar was the first school in which we wanted to hang around after classes. Where we didn't mind using the library, where we felt we were really learning something. Naturally, it was tough, and we all went through periods of depression. There were times when we felt that perhaps the college should make concessions for the veterans in grading. Times when we felt we were being picked on, when professors seemed to have it in for us. Many veterans found their elected courses too difficult, or that they required too much reading. They could not take notes as fast as the girls could, or, if they did, they could not read them. Many of us considered dropping out. Some of us did. I realize now that these feelings are common to most freshmen, but we learned to rely entirely upon ourselves and somehow pulled through those first few months. Then, too, we went away to war for 3.5 or 4 years, where we were faced with problems far removed from classrooms. The classroom picture was an uncomfortable one. Men, average 21, seated beside young ladies or girls 4 years younger and fresh out of school. The men found themselves stumped by problems they had handled with ease 4 or 5 years ago and baffled by casual allusions to Eliot's Wasteland. For our classmates are familiar with Einstein, Freud, Picasso, Beethoven, Descartes, and many others who to us were just names. But it's gratifying to know that they don't completely understand Finnegan's Wake either.
1947. While working at Harvard, Grace Murray Hopper, class of 1928, discovers a moth stuck in a computer, compromising the system. She coins the term debugging on the spot. 1949. Elizabeth Bishop, class of 1934, is named U.S. Poet Laureate.
Rain towards morning. The great light cage has broken up in the air, freeing, I think, about 1 million birds whose wild ascending shadows will not be back, and all the wires come falling down. No cage, no frightening birds. The rain is brightening now. The face is pale that tried the puzzle of their prison and solved it with an unexpected kiss. Whose freckled, unsuspected hands alit.
Faith Merriman Daltrey, class of 1915, writing in 1953.
To the editor. Last June, I was among the hundreds of alumni that returned to Vassar College to renew old friendships and marvel at the changes that are constantly taking place on the campus. I was impressed by the vitality, ease, and grace of the students taking part in the class day exercises. None of them seemed to have any excess weight, round shoulders, fallen arches, or even inferiority complexes. their skit was timely, clever, and fun to watch, but their voices! May I urge that a short speech course be required of all underclassmen who do not pass a simple test for distinct enunciation and a modulated quality of tone.
Billy Davis Gaines, class of 1958.
1954 was a banner year for Vassar. The college not only welcomed three black women into a freshman class of 432, almost 25% of the entire cumulative black student population at Vassar for the past 93 years, but it also hired one black faculty member. I was one of those three black freshmen, the only one from the South, and my life, like that of many other black Americans, was proof that the promise of the Declaration of Independence was yet to be fulfilled. I had never sat anywhere on a public bus but the middle or the back. I had never sipped from a public water fountain or sat in a public waiting room that did not have a sign hanging above it that read, "Colored Only." In late September 1954, standing in the middle of my cubbyhole room on the fifth floor of Raymond House, immediately after my family drove away from Vassar campus, it finally dawned on me. It finally soaked into my consciousness that after having been required for 16 years and 11 months by both Georgia law and the law of self-preservation to have as little to do with white people as possible, I was now going to live, eat, play, and study with them for 24 hours a day, 9 months a year, for the next 4 years. That was a moment I will never forget. It lasted only seconds. The junior who was assigned to be my big sister burst into the room and swept me off to learn my way around the campus.
Elizabeth Moffitt Drouye, class of 1930 and warden of the college.
The Drew!
I think my first recollection of the 60s was the most dazzling experience I had in my time in office. I was sitting at my desk working one morning when a group of five or six students came in and I asked them what I could do. They said, "We want to request permission to picket Woolworths." Well, I tried to keep a straight face and swallowed. Having been at college during the days when students acting on national problems didn't go and ask permission, I said, "I really want to go into this more thoroughly with you than I can now, for I have an appointment waiting." Well, it took me 30 seconds with my next appointment, and I tore out to Sarah Blanding, who in her day was also a radical, and I said, "Sarah, it is the surprise of all time. Our students are still so much in that lethargic, formal, placid state that I just had a group request permission to picket Woolworths." Well, we both sat and laughed. Anyway, Sarah and I borrowed somebody else's car and drove down Main Street to watch them, and it was a very impressive sight. And it was a great, great relief to me, for I thought, maybe the students can take some interest in something except their own mental health.
October 30th, 1969. 34 black Vassar students conduct a peaceful takeover of Main Building in an effort to achieve a number of goals, including full accreditation of and funding for the Black Studies program.
Claudia Thomas, class of 1971.
By 6 in the morning, most of us were awake and apprehensive, awaiting their repercussions of our actions. Maybelle Taylor had mastered the switchboard within 2 hours. At 6:05 a.m., the first call of the day came in. It was Glenn Johnson, assistant professor of political science and assistant to President Alan Simpson.
Yes?
Maybelle answered the switchboard.
"Could you put me through to the president's house?"
"Mr. Johnson, is that you?"
Maybelle asked. She had taken Glenn Johnson's political science course. There was a pause on the other end of the line.
"Maybelle?"
As Mr. Johnson struggled to understand the implications of Maybelle's familiar voice on the telephone, Maybelle put the call through and listened.
"Hello?"
President Simpson answered. His voice was husky with sleep.
"Good morning, Dr. Simpson. I've just learned there's been a student takeover of Main Building."
"What? Main? Main? Is this some kind of prank?"
It was, after all, nearly Halloween.
"No, I'm afraid it's not. Students have occupied the Main Building."
"What students?"
"The black students. I suppose they feel the college hasn't taken their demands seriously."
November 1st, 1969. After 3 days of meetings and negotiations, the protest ends peacefully. The students vacate Maine, leaving the offices immaculate and a bouquet of daisies as a parting souvenir. The college ultimately establishes a permanent Black Studies program that continues to this day as Africana Studies.
Class of 1973.
One very wintry afternoon in 1969, I was traveling to New York to spend the weekend with a friend. It was a new experience for this Vassar freshman, very stylish in my maxi coat, mini dress, and sharp-heeled boots. Out of the wonderfully unknown faces on the train, a burly, boyish, mischievously smiling one rose above the heads and motioned to a vacant seat beside him. Relieved to sit at last, I hurried over and thanked the gentleman coolly, politely. We talked. When he inquired about my work, I embellished my student status slightly. With great aplomb, I became a poet in residence and created a wide array of summer and post-grad opportunities. I felt guiltless. He was a merchant marine who grew up in the Adirondacks. A warm sense of humor and an unsophisticated interest in the world made him a fine companion for the first 30 miles. The conflict arose when he ended a lull by saying,
"You know that a woman's place is really in the home."
We argued from Austining through Yonkers and into Grand Central Station. At 18 at Vassar, my roommates and I were preparing for the presidency, an Academy Award, and the Pulitzer Prize, but never a home and family. I made that very clear while the sailor widened his boyish grin. I was furious. He was confident. Our harsh words finally stopped with the wheels of the Penn Central. Then, against my protests, my friend picked up my onerous suitcase in one hand, his duffel bag in the other, and walked boldly through Grand Central. He found a cab, placed my belongings inside, and said goodbye. He thanked me for my company. I was polite.
Elizabeth Moffat Drouillet, class of 1930.
The following year, namely 1970 to 1971, we admitted the first co-ed freshman class. All my years of school had been with girls only, and my years in college at Vassar were women only. Suddenly I was confronted with housing and dealing with a group of men students. I was quite pleased from the start with the effect it had on the college. Up to that time, if you go on campus on a weekend, you'd think it was the middle of summer. You never saw students around. After the move to coeducation, it really changed, almost overnight. I'd be working on a Saturday morning and just see whole groups of students wandering around the campus. I, for one, have never regretted Vassar's decision to become coeducational.
Stephen Drucker, class of 1974.
We were living in a world where every social convention was a moving target, and we were just moving along with them. But the institution of Vassar, the heart and soul of it, was never in any serious jeopardy.
Not the Shakespeare Garden.
Not the London plane outside the library or the Japanese maples at the center of the quadrangle.
Not deans like Elizabeth Drouillet, whose George Washington profile I would have followed into battle.
Not the amphitheater or the observatory or the daisy chain.
And certainly not the majestic Renwick building that binds it all together spiritually.
Co-education seemed about as current an issue as suffragettism. I no longer find myself telling the same stories about being a Vassar man as often as I used to, and not only because I'm tired of them. What I prefer to tell people these days is that men didn't just change Vassar. Vassar changed men too, preparing us for a world nobody quite envisioned, one where a man may find himself working for a woman. As my classmate Sterling Swan wrote in our reunion book,
"Since Vassar, I've been hopelessly fond of matriarchies."
Michael Civitello, class of 1976.
When I started at Vassar, we didn't like those menacing gray-haired ladies. In our minds, they had all graduated around 1910, who sat on boards and dictated to us. Their sole activities appeared to be putting stop payment on checks made out to the Vassar Alumni Fund, clipping coupons, and making us miserable. In the fall of 1973, I met my first real, live, breathing, thinking, walking, talking, responding, laughing Vassar grad. Rather, I sat down and actually talked with one. This woman was Vassar 31, and a visitor on my home territory, my campus, my turf. The poor unsuspecting woman, I thought that I'd make her visit a co-ed bathroom and listen to two students of the opposite sex giggling in the shower. Blunt, harsh reality. Old Vassar versus new. In 15 minutes, I was hers, totally. She was a vibrant, stimulating, energetic woman, open to all ideas and sympathetic to most. I thought at first this woman might be an anomaly, a rose among the stockbrokers. But I was to meet energetic, bright, and warm alumni again and again. Almost all of them were women to whom assertiveness and tolerance seemed natural, but who looked upon the new Vassar with some misgiving and skepticism. Always, though, they had a fierce pride in their school and implicitly in themselves.
Minna Besser-Geddes, class of 1916, writing in 1977.
My freshman roommate would not talk to me. When I entered the room, she left. What had I done? Why was she so angry? Freshman year was nearly over before I found out. My roommate did not like me because I was Jewish. Would she have left the room to walk out on Sarah Bernhardt? Emma Lazarus? My freshman roommate came from Council Bluffs, Iowa. Had she never met a Jew? The class of 1916 had less than 2% Jews. Today there are 10 times as many. If my freshman roommate were still alive, she could have visited Vassar and seen 60 Vassar girls and boys gathered to celebrate the Jewish Sabbath. On a Friday evening, I went to a meeting of Hillel Club in Rockefeller Hall. At sundown, we listened to talks and songs, we danced, we sang, we ate the traditional Friday evening Hasidic supper. My first Jewish religious experience, and it took place at Vassar in 1973.
Anne Nevin Chamberlain, class of 1942, writing in 1974.
One morning in Alumni House, there were croissants in the bun warmer and a visiting poet across the tea bags. He had lectured in Skinner the night before, and before that had been at Wellesley. He was wondering if Vassar women, pardon, Vassar people, were more combative. Combative? I counted 10 full-blown flaps the first 3 days I was there. Outraged editorials in the Misc, petitions to sign, student senate resolutions, protest meetings, pickets, an ebb and flow of indignations like the tides. Each week, some new outrage elbows aside the flaming issues of the week before. They smolder on the back burner, ready to boil over in the next lull. There are wrangles about the Black Studies program.
Would there continue to be an assistant to the president for Black Affairs?
Would the two leading Black professors reconsider their resignations?
There are disputes about the new addition to the library.
About impeaching President Nixon, or President Simpson, for that matter.
About banning pets.
About whether a new recruiting film demeans Vassar women, showing them in their old lightheaded subservient role.
And whether Vassar men are taking over.
They argue about parking tickets and banning cars.
And while all this is going on, they're writing term papers, producing plays, creating dances, giving music recitals, and studying things like the growth of algae under different lighting conditions over in the luxurious new biology building. It makes my head spin just to think about it.
President Alan Simpson, 1975.
When I came here in 1964, the trustees were worrying about Mary McCarthy. We were so unwilling to have Vassar used as a backdrop for the film, The Group, that the producer hustled off to Connecticut College. A few years before that, it was a scolding of students in the chapel for various improprieties by Sarah Gibson Blanding that made headlines. For 20 years before that, we were a hotbed for communists. In the early years of this century, it was the suffragettes. Didn't Matthew Vassar himself get a bad press? Wasn't Vassar College branded as Matthew's folly? So why do we worry about a bad press? Bryn Mawr could have a black mass or Mount Holyoke a Walpurgis night without anyone being any the wiser, but if a couple take a shower at Vassar, the whole world knows about it before the shower curtains are dry.
Donnell Simonelli, class of 1976, letter to the Washington Post.
As a proud middle-class member of the class of 1976 of Vassar College, I was extremely offended by the insensitive and ignorant remarks of the Education Secretary on the subject of financial aid and frilled divestiture for middle-aged, middle-class college students. 3 weeks at the beach? Neither I nor my parents ever took a vacation anywhere but home during the years I went through school. Stereos? I had a $15 radio and a $25 cassette player for entertainment, plus the same dorm TV that 100 plus other people used. Automobiles? My prized possession was a Sears 5-speed bicycle, which was all the transportation I had other than foot and bus fare. I value highly the quality of the education I have received, and I am proud of and grateful to my parents for the sacrifices they made to pay for it. I applaud the enlightened attitude of schools such as Vassar that emphasize the provision of financial aid to all those who need it, regardless of their family's social status.
Jack Nadler, class of 1978.
In the last 10 years, no change on a national level has been more profound than the transformation in the relations between the sexes brought about by the women's movement. And no institution has been better prepared than Vassar to ready its students to live and work in this world of increasing equality. As a former women's college, Vassar has a tremendous advantage over the schools which once restricted enrollment to men. We have been dedicated to the equality of the sexes throughout our history. Clearly, coeducation only strengthened this conviction. The former men's schools, in contrast, were premised on the notion of male superiority. For them, coeducation was an admission of error. Even now, they still have a lot of catching up to do. Of course, no one can deny that Vassar does not look exactly as she did in 1969, but neither does society. More important is how very much about the college has remained unchanged. We are Vassar, and there is only one of us.
1981, Dizzy Gillespie performs in Skinner Hall.
1983, Meryl Streep, class of 1971, wins her second Academy Award.
1986, the Undergraduate Research Summer Institute, in which science students and faculty collaborate, is inaugurated. The mastodon skeleton, long since relocated to New England building, is accidentally dismantled after someone leaves the janitor a note with instructions to do so. April 1991, the lesbian and gay alumni and alumni of Vassar hold their first ever conference on campus.
Anne Mackay, class of 1949, writing in Wolf Girls at Vassar, 1991.
To be gay at Vassar was to be very lonely. I know now that Vassar was a terrible and beautiful transition time for many women, but the year seemed especially poignant for me, because I knew I belonged there. I loved the college and the people with a great intensity. As a gay person at Vassar, I was a failure. I did not find love and happiness. I followed the gentleman's agreement and loved everybody, and they, in return, elected me president of the College Government Association. It was second best, but I was deeply pleased, because I felt the affection behind the action. The young people today are changing the world, and I am grateful to them. Their freedom is infectious and has liberated me. The delight that lesbian and gay alumni and alumni felt at the April 1991 conference has lasted a long time. A postcard from an older alumna after the conference summed it up.
When my 17-year-old self and I walked our old path through the campus Saturday night, we were light with the gift of freedom.
1993, the Francis Lehman Loeb Art Center opens. 1998, the Intercultural Center is renamed ALANA, an acronym reflecting the students it serves and supports, African American, Latino, Asian American, and Native American.
And the century turns.
Professor Ken Livingston, Spring Convocation, 2010.
5, 6, sometimes 7 days a week, I arrive in Neverland, aka the Vassar campus, where for a century and a half, it has been the case that almost everyone is perennially between the ages of 18 and 22. Oh, there's some effort to age people throughout the year, and we think we're making progress, but then summer comes, the designees of Neverland travel home for a bit, and somebody hits the reset button so that by the end of September, everyone returns with their ages firmly in the allowable 18 to 22 range. Is it any wonder, then, that embodied in this world of eternal youth, it is easy to imagine that one is also eternally youthful?
Kelly Stout, class of 2010, Miscellany News Online, February 17th, 2010.
Question of the week. How was your Valentine's Day? If you answered lonely, predictable, took place in the library, or I ate muffins and listened to Beyonce alone in my room, don't despair. There's probably someone out there who has spotted you from afar and has fallen in love with you. Or at the very least, thinks it'd be fun to sleep with you. After all, we go to Vassar, where romance blossoms year-round. Enter miloslist.org. The most popular part of this website is Missed Connections, a totally not creepy way to tell someone you admire them anonymously.
W4M Thompson Memorial Lives. The only other person in the 1951 reading room on Friday night. I wish I'd been going home with you, bookish hottie in the oversized wool sweater.
M for W, beige suit/scarf. I see you in your conservative tissue scarves from Ann Taylor Loft, like everywhere and everyone seems to know who you are. I really think you could be the one to help me cut course offerings from my
M4M,
major.
M4M, hot meetup at Baldwin. You were pretending to read The Economist in the lobby in a cute American Apparel tee and ironically large glasses. I was wearing plaid and flipping through one of those swine flu informational brochures.
W4W, to the girl who works at the circulation desk. When you took back my overdue copy of the selected political writings of John Locke, you kept my heart.
M4W, brunette hipster in gray lace. Met you by the keg in the downstairs bathroom at the new TH's this weekend. Your total disregard for the personal space of others and lack of self-awareness were enchanting.
W4M, Tasty Tuesday's heartbreaker. I saw you in line for a samosa in the college center. You're one hot, spicy potato, even if your breath smelled like hot, spicy potato.
President Francis Ferguson, commencement 2004.
There is, in America, an epidemic of activity, of the active life so fully lived that there is rarely room for contemplation, for the blissful moments of peace and thought that aren't also afflicted by guilt over things left undone. We see it, often to the advantage of Vassar, in our students, who create such a vibrant life on our campus that sleep and simple downtime seem elusive. We exist within exciting and interesting lives in which sleep and quiet thought are most typically sacrificed to action. Nevertheless, one piece of advice for you today is to seek those elusive moments of solitude and reflection. Enjoy the fact that you have done so well and come so far, and make space in your lives for doing nothing. Nothing, that is, except for the profoundly nourishing and important task of quiet thought.
Professor Robert DeMaria, Fall Convocation 2006.
If you want to avoid the madness that has afflicted me, you must do certain things. First, stay away from the library. Many a happy soul has wandered into those gothic halls a self-satisfied person, conscious of his own omniscience, and walked out filled with the horrible sense of his or her own ignorance. Be careful about listening too closely in class. Sometimes a casual observation by one of your teachers or one of your fellow students will accidentally spark the tinder of your mind and set you on fire. The art gallery, the theater, and Skinner Auditorium can be equally dangerous. You might become inspired there, which is literally to be inflated or blown up. Even if you stay away from those hallowed places, you might be caught unawares. Even those most devoted to intellectual sleep can be awakened in Vassar's learned atmosphere. I have heard of students becoming afflicted with the desire to learn while walking on the path to the old observatory when the weather freshens in the fall, or even while observing the reflections on Sunset Lake. I suppose I don't have to warn you about the new observatory, where you might grow starry-eyed about learning, but also avoid, I warn you, all of the sciences. The laboratory is the quintessential Vassar class. Even the gym is not safe. Sports and exercise teach you about yourself, and what is the end of learning but self-knowledge? One false step in sports, and you might find yourself jogging on the Vassar farm with a fistful of Greek verbs in your hand. If you don't want this to happen to you, be an indolent genius, sleep soundly, and confine yourself carefully to safe places.
Catherine Hill, on her inauguration as Vassar's 10th president, 2006.
When President Raymond was up here at a similar event, Ellen Spaller Richards was a student at Vassar. When President McCracken was up here, maybe for a commencement or a convocation, Grace Murray Hopper, Edna St. Vincent Millay, and Elizabeth Bishop were all students. And when President Taylor was up here, Alice Hyler Ramsey was a student. I hope that when the 20th president of Vassar is up here someday, talking about the future of the institution, he or she will look back to the past and cite the progress our college made at the start of the 21st century. I know that he or she will have a long list of names of accomplished Vassar graduates from which to pick to demonstrate that progress, and I know that many of you sitting here today will be on that list. For that to happen, our students need to continue to be imaginative problem solvers. Let us recommit our energies to Vassar's mission and make the effort necessary to inspire the young people who come to Vassar to find and develop to the fullest the many talents and aspirations they bring with them to this very special place.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 10th president of Vassar College, Catherine Hill.
Thank you. That's just amazing. I hope you will all join me in thanking this remarkable cast and, of course, their director, Chris Grabowski. I also would like us to thank the wonderful Vassar College Choir and Vassar College Women's Chorus, and of course their director, Christine Howlett. What an incredibly wonderful way to celebrate Vassar's 150th birthday. Landmarks such as our sesquicentennial come along only once in a great while. It's important that we acknowledge them because they remind us, as we've been reminded tonight, how much it is worth celebrating. And this is but one of a variety of amazing events we're going to have throughout this year, and I hope you will attend many of them. I'd like to reemphasize a point made by Susan. If you take a look at the printed program, you'll see that everything about tonight's event was put together by Vassar students, faculty, staff, alumni, and alumni. This says so much about what a special place Vassar is. A similar program with professional actors, all Vassar alums, reading the voices, will be presented to alumni and alumni and friends across the country this spring as part of our sesquicentennial celebration. But you've gotten the first look at it, and I think it's just truly spectacular, and I really hope you enjoyed it. There may be something from Vassar's rich history, or maybe from your own experience, that you wish had been included. I know that those putting together this event tonight felt the same way, and we easily could have had a performance that was about 5 or 10 hours long. To everyone here, but especially to the students, let me just remind you, what you say and do now and in the future is going to provide really good material for a similar production when Vassar celebrates its bicentennial in 2061. We're going to conclude tonight's program with another view of Vassar's first 150 years, this time with images rather than words, followed by a closing number from the Vassar choirs. So I'm going to turn it over to the choirs, who will set the mood for a brief film that takes us on a journey from our past to our present.